The Unshackled Waves, episode 36. Unshackled Ways podcast. I'm Tim Wilms, here for another interview show. Our guest for this week, we are lucky to be joined by psychiatrist Dr. Tanveer Ahmed.
Hi, Tim.
He is a clinical psychiatrist. He's also a media commentator and author. He is the author of the recently published book Fragile Nation, Resilience, Vulnerability and Victimhood.
Good, yep, that's the one.
Yeah, which is a collection of observations about Australian society based on patients he's had, which was just recently published by Connoisseur Publishing. So thank you for joining us today.
Thanks, Tim. Pleasure.
And this is our first in-person podcast. Normally the podcast is done, the other person's on Skype, but we're actually in the same room today.
Yeah, we're in a restaurant in inner city Melbourne.
There might be a bit of background noise. That's just because it's the fan and it's really hot in this restaurant, so we're trying to stay cool while we're doing the podcast as well. So we thought we'd invite you on today to talk about your work and also your view about the state of modern society. Now let's start with the beginning. So a lot of people get psychiatrists and psychologists confused. Are you able to explain the difference?
No, you are right. I don't think the public necessarily differentiates between psychiatrists and psychologists. And fair enough. I mean, you know, it is sort of technical. I mean, it's not an obvious thing to understand. So going back, I mean, let's sort of think about I'll try and define what even we mean by mental health. Like, mental health is really three different academic disciplines. So one is neuroscience. So the idea that, you know, we're a jumble of chemicals and hormones and you know, circuits in our brain that leads to emotions and behaviours and thoughts, etc. So that's one branch. The other would be behaviourism, and that's really about, you know, that we respond, we can moderate behaviour through rewards and punishments, and also that what we have thoughts, and then we may have actions associated with our thoughts. So that's really, and to change behaviour, you need to try and change thought patterns, or you can have rewards and punishments, etc. So that's behaviorism. And some people, you know, remember Pavlov's dogs, where, you know, there's a bell and food and the dog responds, and he starts associating the bell with food. So then even when you wouldn't give him food and you rang the bell, he would salivate as if food was coming. So that's an association, it's a reward, all of these kind of things. So, and the last bit of mental health is what we call psychoanalysis, and that's what we associated with, say, Freud. And that's really that we've got a primitive part of us that is instincts and drives, and there's a social world where we suppress that. But meanwhile, it's still playing out underneath. There's this kind of primitive animal part of us that we suppress in to live in society. But meanwhile, you know, what we say or how we behave, and a lot of that we don't even access. So that's a very important part of mental health, that what we say, and, you know, overlaps with politics, where so many people, you know, might say something in a poll or market research, but, you know, it may not correspond with their actual behaviour. So they're the three branches of what we call mental health. Over the years, what psychologists sort of began, kind of like almost nurses to psychiatrists, right, that they were kind of helpers for psychiatrists, but then it evolved into its own discipline, particularly after the world wars. So now what psychologists do is counselling, but at a more technical level, what they do is what's called cognitive behavioural therapy, which is really about trying to help negative thoughts, trying to help people reduce negative thoughts. So for example, you might have a, you know, overdeveloped fear of crowds or, you know, some spiders, whatever it is, you know, could, and part of the counselling is try and recognise the irrationality of that and help you moderate the thoughts. So that's called cognitive behavioural therapy, and that's what the ordinary psychologist does. So for example, if a general practitioner, you know, refers to you to a psychologist, more than likely that's what they'll be doing, as well as, you know, supportive therapy. Whereas psychiatrist, it's where you were a medical doctor, so I did medicine first. At a very lay level, the key difference is we can prescribe tablets.
Yeah,
that's the others can't. So
the easiest difference.
So that's the most obvious difference. But at a technical level, it's meant to be. Psychiatrists are kind of meant to oversee the mental health treatment overall. So be it with a GP or psychologist, whatever it is. But also, we're meant to be dealing in biologically based mental illness. Historically, which is say, you know, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, etc. Historically, that's the differentiation. But I think in modern practice, they're much closer together than they you know may have been academically, because A, we've learned a lot more about biology, such that you know say your garden variety anxiety disorder or something along these lines. There's more of a merger between the neuroscience or the biology of things. And psychological problems. So I think these days, psychology and psychiatrists, they work much closer together. But the most obvious difference is the psychiatrist can prescribe medications.
Yeah, well, that's definitely interesting. Now, let's move on to, I guess, your career journey. So what motivated you to get into psychiatry?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I certainly fell into medicine, but I think I found myself not necessarily stimulated by kind of you know, blood and guts or organs and cutting up surgery. Look, it was still you know fascinating and extraordinary, but it didn't really feel like my thing. You know, partly I was probably a bit clumsy and who knows. But I was attracted to stories and that sort of inner experience, and psychiatry very much overlaps with that. It's very much about the bigger story of your life and how that corresponds to your situation and the distress you feel and that making sense of your experience. So it overlaps a lot more with sort of social or political or metaphysical parts of people's lives. I think with a big disadvantage is because it's so complex and broad, it's actually much harder to do kind of straight interventions. You know, for example, you know, somebody's had a heart attack, bang, you can fix an artery and it's done. With psychiatry, it's often quite broad. So your powers sometimes to, you know, really alter the trajectory of someone's problems can feel more limited. But it's not entirely true in practice, but at an intellectual level, it can be very interesting and very stimulating. So that was my attraction to psychiatry, and I think it was the right choice. You know, it's a very interesting career. And at a deeper level, which I think overlaps with my book, Fragile Nation, I think the way people make sense of their lives now is increasingly through the language of psychology. Particularly, you know, you could argue, you know, we're largely a post-religious society. So I think the way people either do make sense or are asked to make sense of their lives is through the lens of psychology. So that's where being a psychiatrist, you know, I sometimes joke that it's a bit like being a secular priest. And I think there's truth in that, because people come to you in these times of crisis and moral conflict and they're asked to make sense of it through this idiom, if you like. You know, the language of psychology, sometimes tablets and altering behaviour and about their personalities. And that's where, you know, it's a particularly rich field to work in.
Yeah, it's certainly become mental health. It's a field where there is definitely more and more demand for mental health services. What do you think is the driving force behind that? Is it just because there is more awareness these days of the prevalence of mental health, or are we becoming, I guess, more fragile and more susceptible to adversity?
Yeah, look, I think that's a question that goes to the heart of some of the problems of the modern condition, if you like, or some of the challenges. And I mean, the short answer is I don't know for sure. But I guess some of the trends I talk about in the book are, one is that life's project has shifted in particularly the last half century to one of individual self-fulfillment. So really, so everyone's, you know, we're all, you know, trying to work out what's going to fulfill for us, and we're also sort of managing, almost kind of fine-tuning our psychological well-being often. So that, I think, makes us more susceptible because we feel that if I'm not feeling fulfilled, therefore my life doesn't have meaning. We're probably comparison is far bigger than ever. You know, we don't necessarily have the same traditions of class and hierarchy. We're in a secular meritocracy, so there's this feeling that we can all rise to the top, and if we don't, it's almost a sense that, oh, I've failed in some form, I'm not adequately fulfilled. So I think that's one aspect of it. I mean, the other reasons would be, yes, certainly awareness has improved to a significant degree, particularly, I think, the more common disorders like, say, anxiety or depression, etc. But I think a lot of those things often overlap with problems of living. So there is a degree of medicalization of some of those things. But I don't think it's entirely a bad thing. You know, people are more likely to seek help. I think the other aspect is that, I guess, fragmentation of community and family. You know, a lot of collective groups have declined, be it political parties, unions, family structures. So that fragmentation is definitely a factor. So people, we've got less scaffolding, if you like. We're more likely to both experience distress, and then rather than it being cushioned through these structures or channeled in a collective way or dissipated collectively, we're more likely to present as individuals suffering distress. So in that respect, you know, that's another reason, you know, for the rise in the cultural rise in mental health, if you like.
Well, one of the things you talk about in the book is the increasing diagnosis of post-traumatic stress disorder.
Yeah.
Now, I've noticed this in my work with young people who claim they are triggered by ideas they don't like or events that they see. Do you think that this is a concerning phenomenon as well?
Yeah, look, I think the broader point I'd make there is I do think we're increasingly sensitive to the perception of psychological harm. And I think part of the reason is that a lot of measures of psychological harm, like, say, abuse or bullying or prejudice or trauma, as you say, the measures of that have been steadily diluted, often with good intentions. But what it's done is made us, I think, more and more susceptible to the perception that we're being harmed in some way. And not only has that increased, but I also think we're far more likely to project that sense of harm to the outside world. So, i.e. the example you said, you know, that you're exposed to an idea you don't like, rather than sort of thinking, okay, if I'm upset by that idea, that actually has more to do with me and my coping behaviours, or, you know, what I think is acceptable, or how I might respond, and how does that relate to who I think I am and my place in the world, rather than thinking, that actually is more about me and it's my job to try and cope in a healthier way. What we're more likely to do is go, no, that's your fault. That's actually the fault of my employer or my university or the person with me. So that's quite, I think that's something of a shift. And, you know, talking about post-traumatic stress, I think it is actually in part rooted in changes in diagnosis of things like PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder. Post-traumatic stress disorder has a very interesting history. It really came about from the Vietnam War. Yeah, the Vietnam War was very interesting. It's one of the first wars where people came back not as heroes. And in that respect, and there was, you know, obviously all these injuries of a very unpopular war, and then a set of soldiers that weren't heroes, and there were a lot of people who wanted to help these soldiers, if you like, and there was a view that a lot of the distress they felt could be explained you know, entirely by the war. And obviously what we mean by PTSD, be it nightmares, flashbacks, these sort of symptoms. Now, historically, prior to the Vietnam War, the view around PTSD, and used to be called things like shell shock, etc., was that it was quite normal to have those symptoms for a period, might be sort of 3 months, 6 months after you came back from war. But in the vast majority of cases, it passed. And for the people that maintained the symptoms, 9 out of 10 times, they had some sort of vulnerability. Right? They had some sort of psychological vulnerability. So the key thing is about cause. So prior to the Vietnam War, we thought the cause had more to do with the person's makeup than the actual trauma of the war. What changed after Vietnam again, not through any new science, but more through the politics, was we then thought the cause was the trauma of the war and not the person's makeup. So that's, I think that's, it's a very profound change. And I guess it's one of the points in my book is I'm arguing, do we now construct people as innately vulnerable rather than innately resilient? And it comes back with some of these changes in the Vietnam War, because that is really a shift in how you view the human being, and to what extent they're liable to psychologically decompensate in the face of adversity. So coming back to your question, so as a result of that, we're far more likely to attribute our private distress to the outside world rather than our innate coping behaviours. So that's a big shift. So that's at an individual psychological level, but that one that drives, has big impacts in the political social realm. For example, you know, there's a lot more feelings-based laws, for example. If we think about more recently around the gay marriage debate, that's a very good example of where you can argue that, yes, there's no question that homosexuals do have high rates of mental illness. They can suffer identity disturbance. But then the answer is not to go, we can't have public debate because it might upset this particular group. The answer is the people who might be more vulnerable need help being better able to cope with the core tenets of our democracy. So rather yet, you know, you had mental health experts and some of the most prominent ones saying, oh no, they're a vulnerable group and we can't debate them. So based on that argument, really, if you took that argument back throughout the 20th century, you could have argued that for women and blacks and said, oh, we can't debate freedom for women or equal rights for women or blacks. You know, they're too vulnerable. They might get upset, you know. So that's an example of the political, it's an example of the rise of psychological harm, the notion of psychological harm, as a way to limit freedom more generally. So it goes back to the John Stuart Mill idea that the limit of freedom should be where you harm someone. And really, I don't think at any stage he was meaning psychological harm. So that's another result of the rise of psychology and the notions of authenticity and the rise of feelings, which overlaps with the rise of mental health in the past half century, that suddenly psychological harm is now regarded as a way of limiting, as a legitimate way to limit freedom. So I think that's a big shift.
It sounds like the way that you view being a psychiatrist is to encourage people to take more personal responsibility for their actions and their life situation.
Oh, look, definitely. I mean, that's the job of all psychologists, psychiatrists. I mean, there's limitations to that. The reality is, often people are in, crap relationships, or they're in crap jobs and they've got terrible bosses, or they're in a, very difficult society. Say you're in a particularly difficult community, that kind of thing, that's real. So there's limitations on what people can do sometimes. But our job is to try and work within those limitations and sort of go, okay, with you've got various adversities and problems, how can we maximise your potential to adapt to that situation, but also potentially help them sort other stuff out? Do you need legal help, or do you need other resources to potentially influence the non-psychological elements? But often what you see in our work are people who think their problem is in the outside world, be it its work or the employer or their family or society, and then through seeing them, they realise it actually has quite a bit to do with their own development, their own perceptions, and the way they cope and respond to adversity. It's never 100% either way, but that's almost the politics of the consulting room, if you like, where you're kind of shifting their worldview and not projecting everything. I mean, the other aspect about this, if you project everything on the outside world, you lose a lot of control, right? I guess, you know, look, some things are political, and there's no question, you know. I'm not saying people shouldn't get involved in collective movements to try and change things, but when people go, you did this to me, you know, my employer did this to me, or society's done me, so men have done this to me, for example, say in a radical feminism, or women have done this to me in terms of some men's rights movements, you essentially lose a lot of power. You can't, it's really a way of saying I don't have control over my life. You know, I'm entirely a victim, you know, determined, kind of, you know, the analogy is often, you know, you're a boat on this choppy wave, just getting pushed around. So I think a lot of people end up in that sort of situation.
Yeah, it's certainly something that we definitely need to break in this day and age. Now, let's move on to some specific issues that you raise in the book. Now, obviously, one of the more controversial topics, well, not just in Australia, but around the world, is that of refugees, or, well, of admitting refugees into our country. Why is the integration of refugees, in your view, proving such a challenge?
Look, I think for the most part, I guess one of the things I'd say, so refugees, you know, often come from very difficult backgrounds. For the most part, they have been historically been able to integrate often, you know, certainly Vietnamese groups and to some extent Mediterranean. And I think I some points I'd make about this. So one, I mean, the world has changed, right? Certainly from a work point of view, we don't necessarily have large amounts of unskilled work that refugees or new unskilled immigrants can easily slot into. Like, you know, your big snowy mountain schemes or, you know, lots of manufacturing jobs. So that's one aspect where the modern economy doesn't as easily support unskilled work. So it's very hard to suddenly turn up without English, without skills, and then easily integrate. So one is refugees come from often traumatized backgrounds. They lack skills, lack language. Then they need huge amounts of spending often to allow them, help them integrate. And many aren't capable. I guess some of the patients I see, you know, they'd probably be amongst the most unwell. But many of them, the prospects of them integrating in any meaningful form, you know, can be quite low. You know, they, some of them still have victories. And then it can flow on. For the most part, children of refugees can do quite well. But often if you have one traumatised parent or they're struggling to integrate, that sets up funny models for the kids too. And I think that has happened to some extent in some of our communities, particularly Lebanese, to a lesser extent Iraqi, Afghan. You're seeing a little bit about that, where I think it is more of a challenge. So it makes sense. I think it's still important that we take refugees as part of our program. I think we do have responsibility, and they are they're a different type of migrant. So I think they are more likely to be entrepreneurial. They bring a different mix. So I think it's important we take refugees, but the reality is we have to spend lots more money. I think there are more challenges around their integration. So let's be sensible about it. Let's take a small amount, spend the money they need to help them integrate, and also be realistic. And I also believe we should be taking them straight from the refugee camp. So I'm totally supportive of our policy on boats, for example. I think that's appropriate. And I guess the final point on that note with refugees and integration is, with the whole world of Islamic terrorism, often that is partly about, if you think of terrorism as this mix of personal with political resentment, there is the reality, almost everyone in Australia, and to some extent around the world, but not to the same extent, but certainly in Australia, almost everyone who's got involved in, say, terrorism-related activities has come from either a refugee background or they were converts, often from antisocial backgrounds. So we've had, you know, as far as I'm aware, virtually no skilled migrants, or children of skilled Muslim migrants, who've become involved in terrorism-related activities. And I guess my hypothesis for that is Australia is a very socially mobile society. We're a very strong economy. So skilled migrants just far more easily integrate. Any resentments they may have are quickly snuffed out, and they, you know, they integrate far more easily. Whereas the risk is with refugees is they become festering communities of resentment. not necessarily communities, but certainly individuals there. You know, take your man Monis. So those sort of, you know, he's a great example of, you know, he has his own personal vulnerabilities. He comes from a refugee background. He struggled to make it in Australia. So there's all this personal resentment that then got conflated with political resentment. So the cause isn't only Islam, but it has overlaps with Islam. So those groups are far more likely to fall into problems around crime, welfare fraud, and very rarely terrorism. So that's very real. And I know when we bring those up, you know, people, you know, there's massive outcry, you know, as we saw recently with when Peter Dutton said something along those lines. I mean, that's real, and I see that in my work, you know, probably daily, and you're trying to help them, and often you can. But they're real challenges, and to pretend that doesn't exist is just, you know, they're just acts of denial, really. And often you're not even helping them either. You're not helping these people that need help by pretending these problems don't exist.
Yes, I know how difficult it is to have a civil discussion about difficult topics. Now, let's move on to, you touch on in the book, obviously, the problem with Islamic radicalization, and you offer an explanation for why it appears that so many second-generation Muslims are becoming more radical and more devout. So would you like to just touch on that?
Yeah, sure. I mean, look, in some ways I came to writing, and I guess a whole generation of Muslims right around the world became politicized through recent events, you know, September 11th, etc. And I probably fell into that category, but I was never particularly religious. I came from a more, you could say, secular, if not atheist, certainly agnostic. I come from Bangladesh, and even the foundations of Bangladesh are kind of this conflict between secular liberalism and Islam, or Islamism, if you like. You know, our community probably reflects that. And my families have probably always been from this kind of secular humanist sort of angle. So I probably got interested in the topic because I could see people around me of my background becoming unusually religious while we were growing up. And you could see that it was their way of finding belonging and a sense of identity, hence they grew beards or wore hijabs. And often they were more religious than their parents. So it was very interesting, this religiosity. And that is a unique factor of Muslim communities, where often second, third, latter generations, they often become more religious than their parents. Every other group tends to become less religious. And I would argue, in part, that is a reflection of belonging and integration sometimes, where they, for various reasons, they have more trouble feeling like they're part of the broader community. One of my arguments is often Muslim groups, and this goes back to my broader argument about people more likely to blame the outside world. In Islamic communities, they're far more likely to blame things on racism, discrimination, etc. Whereas I would argue they often self-segregate first. So, i.e. right from their households, they might receive messages that, yeah, we're here for the material benefits, but we're worried about the freedoms of the society and its potential to corrupt our youth, if you like, you know, be it sex, drugs, etc., godlessness. So often that segregation actually comes from Muslim communities to some extent. I think it's improving, but not entirely. I mean, for example, Islamic schools are amongst the fastest rising sectors of independent schools. So I think often what happens in Muslim communities, there's a self-segregation where they're often the ones that go, oh, actually, we're going to try not to mix to protect ourselves. But then when people point that out, the response will be, oh, no, you're racist and you discriminate against us. I mean, look, definitely, there's no question there's racism and discrimination, and I think it's a very real problem. But I think often Muslims are very quick to accuse the mainstream of racism and discrimination when there's a great deal of self-segregation and racism and discrimination within the community itself.
Yeah, it's certainly an interesting insight, and hopefully what you said then, it's we can overcome this with the Islamic community. But let's talk about one of your chapters is called Angry White Men. which talks about their disillusionment, disaffectedness of the white working class with the with the decline in manufacturing job, and just a feeling like that they are forgotten. And obviously this was encapsulated with the election of Donald Trump. A lot of his support came from the white working class. So would you care to talk a bit about that phenomenon and how that's affecting our society?
And look at, so I guess where I work, part of my practice is in Western Sydney. Traditionally, you know, I work working class neighbourhoods. So I certainly get a set of patients, often from workers' comp or sent by their employer, of people who might have been made redundant or have suffered a work injury. And a lot of that's happened in those sort of areas where there used to be strong manufacturing base, but most of it's, you know, been outsourced or, you know, downsized or mechanized in some form. So you do see a lot of people exactly that sort of, you know, the so-called Trump vote in a way, where the world has sort of passed them by. The modern economy doesn't seem to have a place for them. They're struggling to adapt to the service jobs that are there. And not only are all these things happening, they're being told that they're privileged.
Yes,
because they're male and they're white. So that understandably creates a lot of resentment. And meanwhile, they can see, I profile a patient who walks around the area, kind of sees all these services for immigrants and refugees, and meanwhile he can't get insurance to, you know, pay his what he thinks he's due. So it builds a lot of rage, where, and he's lived in his neighbourhood for, you know, generations, and he feels like, well, this isn't my local anymore, this isn't my community or my neighbourhood. So it builds up all this rage and resentment. And some of that can then get channeled again outward into saying, oh, interracial, you know, be it white nationalist groups or men's rights movements. And again, a lot of these are movements, resentment-based movements. They may have a grain of truth, but then they become kind of bigger than the foundational realities. So I think that has a lot of overlap with what's happened, be it, say, Brexit or Trump, where, you know, increasing the left really became about your identity, about psychology and authenticity. It became about feelings, and also became about the professional classes. It really became about professionals, particularly living, say academics or the cultural class, particularly living in the inner city, and increasingly just became completely distant from its roots in the working classes. And, you know, I'm hardly the first person to say it, but that, I think, was a big driver of some of these movements. I think Australia is a little bit luckier in the sense that we probably have stronger, we've got quite a strong economy, we have stronger social safety nets. So these things, I think, will cushion us to some extent, but that's not to say, you know, the same trends aren't apparent.
It's quite bizarre to say to a homeless white man that he's got white privilege. I mean, it's not doing him much good there. Now, the title of your book is, as we've said, Fragile Nation, and it appears that we're all more anxious in this current era about a lot of things, but there's also, I'm sure you've heard of the book The Rational Optimist by Matt Ridley, who argues, contrary to what we believe, things are actually better than they were 50, 100 years ago, and we're actually living in one of the best times to be alive. What's your take? Is society moving forward, or are we at a tense time?
Oh, look, I think that is. Overall, I do think that's true. And I think, you know, we do live in the most peaceful, prosperous times in history. I mean, that's the reality. I think immigrants are a very good measure of this. You know, with my background, we often have relatives coming and staying with us because they're studying or trying to get, you know, permanent residency. And, you know, most of them will come to Australia and just look around and go, there are like no problems here, you know. And so they're often the most grateful for being here and can see how extraordinary life is. So I think when you have any sense of the wider world, you know, the reality is often the grievances that people, you know, throw out here, if not trivial, they're minor in comparison. But I do think there's a broader grievance culture. And I guess one of the points of my book is, part of that grievance is really people trying to make sense of their lives and trying to get meaning in a more secular, post-religious world where they have fewer collective connections. So there's all this individual grievances and failing to make sense of that at you know, in a metaphysical sense or a coping sense. I think a lot of it just gets projected out into various grievances in the wider society or in our wider politics. So I think that is at least part of what's going on. I don't think it necessarily explains everything. I mean, there are, you know, there are certainly things to fight for in a political sense, but I think that's part of what's going on at the moment. And you see lots more ups and downs. I'm sure the modern media stuff, etc., is part of it. We have a lot more social media, and suddenly everyone's got a voice, everyone's a publisher, and so there's this whole decline of authority figures in general. And I see that in my work as a doctor, actually, where, you know, people can look up things and they bring in the information, which is great. I think there's been a real democratization there, and you see that everywhere. Where your job as experts now is often to work in partnership with patients, whereas before you're more of this all-knowing authority figure. So in a way, it's good that's been, you know, knocked over. But I think that's happened right across the board, where suddenly, you know, we barely respect politicians, we barely respect other, you know, be it scientists or other figures. So there is this big vacuum in sort of moral authority. So people don't know where to reach for that kind of thing. You know, often that void gets filled by, you know, highly unorthodox or new characters, you know, like, say, your Trumps, or, you know, could be Kim Kardashian or something, you know, like all manner of things. There's a huge vacuum there now.
Yeah, that's certainly interesting, because, yes, living standards have increased, but also the structure of our society has changed so much, which, of course, is not without consequence as well.
Yeah, look, I mean, I think, yeah, there's certainly a lot of cultural anxiety, no question. I mean, where Freud actually wrote a book about Between the World Wars called Civilization and Its Discontent. And really his broader point was the world changing too fast for our coping abilities to cope with, right? Were we capable of adapting, you know, in a way? That was one of the key points of the book. But I actually think we're potentially going through a time like that now, where there's so much change, so much disruption, and partly there's kind of, it's almost like we're not almost entirely equipped, not all of us anyway, to kind of adapt to that. So it's creating whole sets of, you know, anxieties and grievances. So I do think that in that respect we are going through, we'll probably look back on this period, so certainly the last decade, and I'm sure, you know, it'll go on for a while yet, as you know, fairly extraordinary sort of period in history in terms of the level of, you know, societal and disruptive sort of change.
Even though there is a lot of upheaval in the world, I still am glad that I'm born today and I get to experience all this modernity. So,
no question. I mean, look, it is extraordinary. As a doctor, I mean, what you see, say, in medical science, for example, is just, it really is extraordinary. And, you know, you think how peaceful our societies are. And part of my politics is, in some ways, has been driven by that, where I'd often go back to Bangladesh every few years growing up, probably less so now as an adult because I have a young family, but where you just see how hard it is to set up the most, what we take for granted, simple things like just functioning courts, you know, being able to say what you want and not get, you know, attacked or killed for it. You know, people just being able to have ordinary debates that don't end up in violence, just functioning infrastructure and roads and traffic lights. Like, there's all these extraordinary things that we take for complete granted here. And look, most of us, you know, a lot of Australians travel, so they do begin to have a sense of that. But I guess that's where I have become a sort of convert, to, you know, almost the so-called enlightenment convert, if you like, because having seen, say, my ancestry and other parts of the world, and seen how difficult it is to set out some of these things around just the worth of an individual, laws and courts and a functioning political system and high quality infrastructure. I mean, these are extraordinary achievements, but I think the ordinary person just takes it for granted. I mean, even our safety net is extraordinary. Mm. It really is. Like, someone on a disability pension is wealthier than 95% of the world, can live, you know, in a degree of comfort, and meanwhile has access to world class education and health. I'm not saying they're living the life of luxury, but we do have an extraordinary, everyone is largely looked after in our society.
Yeah, that's definitely something to be thankful for. Now, I want to finish off by just talking about your politics, because you've been active in politics, you're a member of the Liberal Party, and you're a councillor in a local council area in Sydney. Now, obviously, with your Bangladeshi background, you don't fit the conventional left-wing stereotype that all migrants are meant to support the left. So how did you, obviously we've talked about your views today, but sort of why was the right side of politics the best fit for you?
Yeah, look, I certainly was left, you know, like typically a bit, I guess, Churchillian, you know, where you, when you're young, you're left. So certainly at university, I was young Labour. I mean, I did medicine, which isn't naturally one that flows into politics. But I think just observing the world through my work, through being in an ethnic community too. So well, you kind of see, you. I feel like I've had a kind of a spectator seat in a lot of these migration flows, and be it asylum seekers or other types of migration, and you get a sort of, I see a lot more of the ins and outs of what happens in those worlds. I see the underclass and what happens in there, and how, the much more, the grey areas of that, where often in the left, you know, it's all about, you know, so-and-so, it's this black and white, so-and-so is the underdog, so-and-so is the person in power, and they can't see beyond that sometimes, you know, all the complexity. So they get stuck in so-and-so's the underdog, therefore we can't possibly, you know, scrutinise them in another meaningful way. So I think when I started writing about that, and often just making simple observations, I wouldn't say I necessarily started saying, oh yes, I'm a conservative, but it seemed to be where I was starting to, you know, agree with people more. Just from trying to be dispassionately reasonable. Now, that's not to say, you know, I think both left and right have their ideologues and, emotion-fueled arguments, no question. But I wouldn't say I feel like some big, strong conservative. I wouldn't say I'm I see myself as a big sort of social conservative, but I probably have, the world is not in simple categories of, you know, good, bad, or this person's in power and this person's the underdog. I think a lot of those things have very much been usurped. And certainly, a lot of these identity politics thing, I think that has, you know, it has divided society a lot. And certainly around Islam, I am someone that's developed a view that there are real problems there. And the vast majority of Muslims self-formulate their beliefs, which are compatible with Australian values, but then they're in a degree of denial about what's in the Quran. They pick and choose the texts they like, but the ones they don't like, they sort of say, "Oh, that's out of context," you know, which it may well be. But at the heart of that is still underneath that. But no one will be willing to come out and say, "Well, I actually don't believe it's the literal word of God," right? So that's. That's a shift that has to happen, and so me just taking, I guess, a dissident position on Islam, that automatically shifts you to the right. So I don't know. It's not like I embrace the conservative side, if you like, but as soon as you take certain positions there, so if you don't see terrorism as a function of racism, discrimination, etc., suddenly you're not necessarily of the left. So that's partly why I've probably been pushed to the right. Because some of my views in some of these areas. Likewise in gender, for example, where in my work I can see problems, say, you know, men from the working class or ethnic backgrounds are happening, and me kind of writing or speaking about that or advocating about that suddenly creates, you know, tensions within leftist circles sometimes. And that's where it feels like, well, what's going on here? Are you actually trying to help people in front of you? Or are there all these wedded ideologies? You know, it's often more about them and their turf, if you like. But that happens on both sides. You know, that's hardly limited. But I think, more recently, I think it's happened almost more on the left.
Yeah, it sounds like me, you've been on a political journey where you've observed the various political and social movements, and for you, just the right has seemed like the natural home for you. That's about all we've got time for on today's podcast. So thank you, Tanveer, for coming on this show. And it was quite an enlightening discussion. I'm sure our listeners would have enjoyed your insights.
Pleasure. Thanks, Tip, and good luck to the Unshackled.
And we will leave a link to Tanveer's book in the description, Fragile Nation. So if you want to purchase a copy and read more of his views, then just jump on and purchase the book from our friends at Conocorp Publishing. Also, at the end of the show, the usual reminders. So don't forget to subscribe to the Unshackled newsletter at theunshackled.net/subscribe. Don't forget to consider supporting the website at theunshackled.net/support. And also, before I go, we do have some exciting news about the podcast. We will be expanding the podcast series in the future, adding some different types of episodes, so make sure you stay tuned for that. Also, don't forget to subscribe to this podcast on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, or view the video version on YouTube. Thanks once again for listening, and we'll see you next time.